Let's try it again. Good morning, everyone. Let's stand on our feet and let's worship this beautiful Sunday morning. So thankful to be here today.
Gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're seeing. Every part of us.
goodness and your mercy to us, Lord. Yesterday I was just, being very spiritual and scrolling through Facebook and Reels and, how you get stuck in those moments. And don't judge me, you guys do it too. But I got caught up on this reel, and this guy was talking about Jesus and the parable of the fig tree. And I don't know if you know the story or not, but Jesus had just made his grand entrance into Jerusalem, and everyone was shouting, Hosanna, and praising Jesus. And then he went, after that, he went into the courts and into the church, and he overthrew the tables because, they were selling things in his house. And he said, my house should be a house of prayer and worship, and he was all upset about that. And anyway, after that, the next morning, he was going back into Jerusalem, and he saw this fig tree, and he saw that it had leaves on it, and he was hungry, so he went over to it, and there was no fruit on the fig tree. And Jesus cursed that fig tree, and it immediately withered up, and it died. And the disciples were just like, wow, how did that happen? And Jesus, he said, if you see this mountain be moved, and you have enough faith, it will move. And I just couldn't help but think about that. But there's another aspect of that fig tree that I was thinking of. And I thought, this is Jesus. He, even the waves and the ocean, the winds and the ocean obey him. When he was on the boat, he said, peace be still, and they obeyed. I mean, Jesus could have went up to that tree and said, give me a fig, and it should have produced. But it didn't. And so I just kind of was thinking about ourselves and our own lives and just going, Lord, sometimes we're so stubborn, aren't we? We come into your presence and we just go, oh, we're here. It's another Sunday. We made it. We're doing our little checklist. But man, when we come into the presence of the Almighty God, our lives should be changed. We should come with expecting hearts of God. Here we are. Change us, Lord. I don't want to be stubborn. I don't want to be set in my ways any longer, Lord. Lord, let us have open hearts to receive, Lord, all that you have for us today, God. Whatever it is that we are needing, may we have faith to believe, God, that you are more than able, Lord. You are capable of healing our bodies, Lord, of changing our minds, our situations, and our circumstances. God, you are faithful, God. Hallelujah, Lord. We just love you, Lord, and we're just going to worship you this morning. We worship you, Jesus.
Jesus, you change everything. Life's healed, hope found here now. Jesus, you change everything. Chains fall, fear bow here now. Jesus, you change everything.
We are. Lord, we know, God, that our lives are changed when we stand in your presence, Lord Jesus. There's nothing like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Jesus. We worship you, Father. Hallelujah. And the church said amen and amen. Hallelujah. Children, you may be dismissed. And why don't you just take a moment and just greet someone?
Well, good morning, Bethel Church.
Morning. Welcome.
Do you have to have your mic on?
Yeah, I turned it on.
Mic on would be good.
Testing. 1, 2, 3. Are you all ready for us?
I like how Jamie is like, yeah, I'm ready for you. Bring it on.
Good
That's
morning.
Awesome.
We're so glad you're here today. Isn't it a privilege and a honor to worship in the presence of the Lord.
Absolutely. It is the best day of the week to be able to be in his presence.
Hashtag best day of the week.
Thank
I got
you.
It this
good
time.
Job. Good job. Hey,
I was still asleep earlier.
I just want to say, isn't it nice to have her back?
Aww. That's great. That's very good.
Thank you.
Did Savannah come up with that?
Yes, we did. I missed her. It's boring up here without her, apparently.
I heard you were boring.
It's not as funny.
And you were trying. They just didn't understand your humor.
No, apparently not. They didn't know that I was trying to be two people at once. Hey, good job. Hey, no, if you are a first time, second time, or third time guest here, we are so glad that you are here with us. If you're joining us online.
Welcome. Are you glad they're here? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. If you are joining us online, you need to be here. You need to be, applause, yeah. Just keep going to that, okay? Hey, we have a few things going on here.
Only a few.
As we've mentioned, August is very busy, and we are in August now, so it's going to be crazy. But hey, next Saturday, the 12th, we're having our block party here. Woo! I told you, just keep putting, thank you. Yep. We're still collecting school supplies for the block party, and we're going to have inflatables here, and it's just an opportunity to serve the community, and it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, that was my.
That was yours.
That's okay.
Well, see, there's something I didn't add on there, so yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
Anyway, next, the Sunday is also going to be our back to school. See, I'm here by myself last week. I'm used to just going through them, and now she's back.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Did give me a chance.
Hey, take it easy. We're having our back to school on Sunday, our service, and we're going to be praying for the students, and we're also going to have an ice cream social after a service. So we're raising money to buy Bibles for students, so it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. We also have baptisms coming up on August the 20th. We're going to have an outdoor service along with baptisms. Sign up is on the website. So if you don't know the website, I'm going to tell you. It's mybethelchurch.com.
Yeah, good job. She was going to tell you there. That's
so
awesome.
Just click on baptisms, and there's a link there for you to register. I looked it up.
What do we got going on August 23rd?
Small groups, that's me.
Yeah, small groups, being kicked off.
I took your baptisms and not
Yep. Hey, we're winging it up here. It's all good.
Yeah, we got small groups coming up on Wednesday, August 23rd, being kicked off for the fall.
Absolutely. Hey, August 30th. Yeah, we just keep going down the list there in August. Prayer and worship night. It's going to be here.
So we kick off small groups, and then the next Wednesday we don't have small groups.
That's right. Yeah. So, but still, come anyway. So we're going to be worshiping, and it's going to be an awesome time.
And we have three ways to give this morning. We have online, easiest, fastest, securest way.
We have mail it, the slowest possible, maybe not securest
snail
way.
Snail mail.
Yep. And we have the gray box in the back.
Yeah.
Or a brown box. I said gray.
It's a brown box. I want to call it red. We're colorblind.
What kind of
here.
Colors are there anyway?
Yeah.
Hey, mark your calendar because we have something going on in September as well.
Something in September.
No more August. I'm tired of August, man. Already. I just want to get to the burr months.
It's only six.
September, October, November, December.
Good one.
Thank you. Man, burr. Yeah.
That's because he likes winter.
I do like winter. Yeah, anyway, thank you. You need to put a laugh up there, too. All right? Anyway, September 20th, we're going to be having a concert. We don't have any details, sorry. I'm just kidding. The joke is we literally had no details and we had no idea what concert this was, but it was on the slide. Yeah. So anyway, take a look at this video for more details on the concert.
It'll tell you about it.
Everybody at Life Community Church, it's Darren here with We Are Messengers, and I just heard the good news that we're coming back your way. We're bringing our Where the Joy Is tour to the church on September the 20th. That's a Wednesday night, and it's going to be incredible. Joining us in the night will be Michael Cochran and Mr. Ben Fuller, and I think these guys are writing some of the most wonderful songs around right now. So we want you to be there. The tour is brand new. It's called Where the Joy Is because we got new songs and a new lease of life. We know where the joy is. It's always found in Jesus. So we want to come share that with you, and hopefully you will share that with us.
When Compassion presents We Are Messengers Where the Joy Is Tour with special guests Cochran and Company and Ben Fuller. Wednesday, September 20th in Columbia at Life Community Church.
Magnify no other name.
Amen. Hey, so this is September 20th. Yes, it takes place at Life Community Church in Columbia. They have a good-sized venue that they use to put on concerts there at the church. And so September 20th, it's going to be there with We Are Messengers. If you don't know who they are, just turn on Joy FM sometime and you'll hear them. They're one of the biggest bands out there right now traveling. And that was Darren, which was kind of cool because the same day they locked that concert in, Darren put that video together and sent it over, so it was kind of cool. But Ben Fuller and Cochran and Company, all these singers are on Joy FM, if you know what Joy FM is. I know some don't listen to Joy FM, and they listen to bot radio, so a bot radio probably wouldn't have them on there. But if you listen to Joy FM, they're there. So it'll be a wonderful time. And yes, it's on a Wednesday night. So I hope some of us will be able to go down for that concert. I know some of you might want to still be here and have Bible study, which is fine, but I'm just giving another option for us to get involved and be a part of the bigger church. So I encourage you to make plans to do that. I'll give more details next week as far as where you can buy tickets at, and we'll go from there. Amen? Amen. Amen. Hey, so we're in 2 Thessalonians, and we are in chapter 2. This week, and so it's going to be on your app, YouVersion, or you follow along on the screen today, and we're just going to kind of go right through the scripture this morning to take a look at what Paul is saying to the Thessalonians again. Paul does some interesting things, which I find it's pastors do the same thing, where they have to repeat themselves a few times. You know what I'm saying? And so Paul does some things here where he realizes he has to repeat some things to reinforce the message, but also encourage them, lift them up, and keep pointing them in the right direction. And so that's what we're doing as we discuss and we look into how Paul wrote these letters and what he had to say to us. And so let's jump in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we'll jump right in here. It says, "Now, dear brothers and sisters, let us clarify some things about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and how we will be gathered to meet him." So see what I'm saying? He's going, I got to clarify some things again for you. So I don't know if things were foggy, if you didn't get it, you weren't listening, or you're being persuaded in another direction, because that's obviously some of those things are playing out here. And verse 2, it says, "Don't be so easily shaken." All right, we're going to land on that verse quite a bit. "Don't be so easily shaken or alarmed by those who said that the day of the Lord has already begun. Don't believe them. Even if they claim to have had a spiritual vision, a revelation, or a letter supposedly from us." Now, there's been a few over the centuries that have tried to spell out the date, tell us when, have a special revelation of when. Nobody knows the time or hour the Lord cometh, all right? I even said cometh for some of us today. Just so we clarify that, just in case, the King James folks. Clarity is the key of what Paul's trying to spell out to us and remind us of. And we need clarity today. Come on, we need some clarity today in our world where it can be very confusing on who to follow and what to listen to. Amen. Whether it's churches, pastors, our government, or your local conspiracy theorist, or your self-help books, or your education system. There's a lot that gets thrown at us, right? Amen. Technology has thrown so much at us that we get bogged in and down into what to believe and what to know. The only way that you will navigate this life is that you know the Word of God. You have your ears open to the voice of the Spirit of God, not to one specific pastor. I love that you listen. Love that you're taking. I hope that you are. I hope that I keep us focused. But you don't take it solely on my word. Okay? You don't solely take it on your favorite pastor that you watch on TV. I think they still have TBN out there and other television like that, but now your favorite one that you jump into and listen to. You have to make sure that you listen to one message and one message alone. What does the Bible have to say? What is Father God, the King of the world, the universe, saying to you through his word? And this morning, that's what we're trying to do. What does his word say to us for now? Right now, what is he saying to us? And so he lays it out. Don't be easily shaken or alarmed. So there's two things. Don't be alarmed. The world is chaotic. It's a mess. Don't be shaken by it. Don't fall into fear, all right? Don't be fooled. He goes on. Don't be fooled by what they say. For that day will not come until there is a great rebellion against God and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the one who brings destruction. So take a chill pill. Don't worry. He's got it under control. Jesus, Father, is telling us the things that are to come so that we don't have to walk in fear. That your life is anchored on Jesus. That you don't get tossed here and there by everything that's being thrown at you today. That you are anchored in the Word. You know the direction. You know that there's going to be hell to come. There's going to be trials to come. There's going to be tribulations to come. The United States might not be the United States that you love and cherish. We are not the supreme that we think we are sometimes. Because God has written it and he is laying it out for his purposes. Our nation needs an awakening. We need kicked in the, okay, once in a while. We need to be shaken. We need to get on our knees. And sometimes in our world, we have to have some major pain to come our way so that our focus begins to be attuned to Jesus and not to your selfish needs and what you think you deserve. We think we deserve it all. And we think we don't deserve any suffering to come our way. I have to tell you, suffering is part of following Jesus. Hallelujah. It just is. You will not make it through this world without some suffering. Yes, there's different levels of that. Yes, this coming year, you might see some good. You might see some oppression, suffering coming. You might see some turning really taking place. Well, okay, God, what are you doing in our world? What are you saying right now? What opportunity does the church have to be the church in our country right now? What are you telling us to do? What do we need to stand on? What principles do we need to read and study in your word, line upon line, precept upon precept? Every I dotted. Jesus has it all planned out. We just need to follow him. So don't be fooled by what they say, for what that day will come. There's a great rebellion against God. You might be seeing it right now. There's a great rebellion against the things that are true. It doesn't matter what's true. There's an ideology and there's an evilness taking place, and that's what's being pushed, all right? And there's a man of lawlessness, all right, being revealed. The one who brings destruction, he will exalt himself and defy everything that people call good and every object of worship. Defy everything that people call good. Think about that. I'm thinking of Mr. Rogers right now. And I won't repeat what he said. I don't know the audience, but he talks about boys and girls. And he explains why. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. That used to be just, that's it, right? But now that is not true. That's what the world is telling us. That's what the culture is telling us. I agree that that is destructive. That is evil. That is directed by the man himself, Satan. That's as evil as you come to destroy our kids and destroy the generation coming up. He will exalt himself and defy everything that people call good. See what I'm saying? And every object of worship. He will even sit in the temple of God claiming that he himself is God. Don't you remember that I told you, now Paul's telling, don't you remember that I told you about all of this when I was with you? Don't you remember that Jesus is the only way, church? Don't you remember that God created man and woman? He created our world and our universe and everything that is beautiful. He is majestic and awesome, and he did it all. And he loves you and a purpose for you. You don't have to change. Listen, your heart has to change. You are who you are. You are a man. I know I say this a lot, but I think it just has to be spelled out all the time. You are a man. You are a woman designed by God to be who you are. And we are to be instruments that bring worship to Jesus. We are to point to Jesus. Nothing else matters. So we need to know that there is no other truth. 2 + 2 will always be 4, no matter how long that they want to make math. Right? You like that? And you know what is holding him back? For he can be revealed only when his time comes. For this lawlessness is already at work secretly. We're seeing it. He's working. And it will remain secret until the one who is holding it back steps out of the way. Till the Spirit of God steps out of the way. Then the man of lawlessness will be revealed, but the Lord Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth. Have you smelled some coffee breath before? Ooh, I tried to keep my mints going, man. With the breath of his mouth and destroy him by the splendor of his coming. This man will come to do the work of Satan with counterfeit powers and signs and miracles. We know there is a counterculture. There is a counter Christ. He is the Antichrist that will come and be this supposed God. He will use every kind of evil deception to fool those on their way to destruction because they refuse to love and accept the truth that would save them. They refuse the truth. So God will cause them to be greatly deceived and they will believe these lies. Have you ever believed some lies? Have you ever made a lie? Then they will be condemned for enjoying evil rather than believing the truth. As for us, we can't help but thank God for you, dear brothers and sisters, loved by the Lord. We are always thankful that God chose you to be among the first to experience salvation, a salvation that came through the Spirit who makes you holy and through your belief in the truth. He called you to salvation when we told you the good news. Now you can share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. With all these things in mind, dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. We've talked about that this past year. Stand firm and keep a strong grip on the teaching we passed on to you, both in person and by letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God, our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal comfort and a wonderful hope, comfort you and strengthen you in every good thing you do and say. Oh, the scripture is so beautiful. How many of you growing up had this type of fear that I don't know how many of you grew up in church, but growing up in church, there was moments where the things that I heard and the things that I interpreted scared the snot out of me. You know what I'm saying? Hell scared me to salvation. Hell scared me. Every time I thought I did wrong, I better start repenting. Because if I didn't, I was going to miss it. You ever been in that spot where you thought you were going to miss it because your life wasn't right? Maybe you have to go back a few years. You ever had this kind of dream in your life where you're dreaming and you dreamed that the train took off without you? And that train was Jesus, and he done left me behind. You ever been there? Or you ever got so scared in church growing up that, remember this? Remember HBO? Remember what it stands for? Hell box office. It's hellish. HBO, it's from hell. I remember hearing messages. Remember the Smurfs? Them demonic little blue people. You know what I'm talking about? He-Man and some witchcraft taking place in it. Simpsons, man, they're demonic too. You know what I'm saying? Like, just scare you, just preach hell into you. Fear, just make you fear what Jesus is doing, what Jesus is coming back. He's coming back, and you think at any moment, if your life, if you had one thing that you screwed up on, man, you had one sin in your life, you think, man, it's it. I know, I understand. Scripture says Jesus is coming back for church without spot or wrinkle. But without Jesus, God's going to find a whole lot wrong with me. Because until I go home, I ain't going to be perfect. I ain't going to be right. I got sin after sin that's going to show up in my life. And if he's banking on that today I'm going to be living this sinless life, I'm sure at some point I'm going to be selfish. Some point, you're going to cut somebody off. At some point, all us church people are going to go eat dinner, eat lunch somewhere, and we're going to get real impatient. And when we get impatient, we're not going to give no tip. We're not going to tip that person. It's terrible, terrible service. And they all know church people walking in. They all see it. They know exactly who you are walking in. And sometimes they go, oh, God, here comes the church people. Here they come. Now you're going to miss it. You're going to miss the rapture now. Because you just got impatient with your waitress. You didn't give her no tip. You even got snarky and snarly with her. And showed no love. That's none of you, right? All right. Second Thessalonians chapter 2 and 1 through 4 again. Don't be so easily shaken or alarmed, or another way, easily troubled. Easily troubled. Don't be shaken by what might take place. There's all kinds of things that are going to take place out of our control. Don't be troubled. I remember one time driving back to Arizona in a snowstorm. And I like driving when the weather's bad. I don't know. I like it. I don't know if I take it on like as a challenge. Like, can I get through this? Am I going to make it through to my destination? It's a blizzard and 4 feet of snow on the ground, but I'm going to keep driving. But I can remember in my, yes, a conversion van. You remember the white one I had? I don't know, it was a smaller one, but driving it back to Arizona and going through Kansas. You ever drive through Kansas? It's such a horrible state. Like, there's nothing going through Kansas. Just like 70 going straight, there's nothing out there. Some towns they call cities, it's not a city. You're in the middle of nowhere. But I don't even think we had kids yet. And I only bought this van because I was a youth pastor. I needed places to put kids and shove them in. I remember shoving kids to drive 4 hours away to a concert. And it was like sardines in the van. There's kids laying on the floor and sitting on the floor. We didn't have enough seats, but I probably put 15 people in this little van somehow. But anyway, back to driving through Kansas. Driving through Kansas and snow coming down and it's bad. You're just like crawling. And we're talking about, do we stop, do we do whatever, you know, but I just keep on driving, right? I'm just, this is great. And a few minutes later, here we go. This is fun now. Like, I'm off in the median, in between the interstate. I'm like, just hold on, because we're not stopping. And just kept on going. I can get trouble, just snow on the ground, just snowfall, we're good. Just punch it, right? I had all-wheel drive on this van, so I thought it was like this. I am unstoppable. No fear. Just drove right through, got right back on the interstate, and we kept driving. It wasn't trouble. Now, I don't know what Teresa was thinking. She is probably holding on for dear life, and because typically, Teresa's holding on to whatever she can hold on to, even to this day. She don't say too much now. Now, she just holds on. I'm like, what are you worried about? I'm not troubled. In our world, we will face troubles. In our world, we will see chaos. And if anything brought about fear and trouble was the last 3 years of going through COVID. Now, you remember what it looked like the first few days and the weeks that came out? I don't know what you thought. Like, oh, God, this is the end of the world as we know it. I was playing the song too. And man, I even found that I had fear. Come on, I know I'm not alone on that. I know you are all Bible believing, faith filled, like, but man, I have to say that, like, I wasn't sure, man. They're showing streets filled with dead bodies and piling up, and what are you gonna build mass graves in our own country? You remember these things? Or have you forgotten? Remember that, like, churches are shutting down. closing the doors. Businesses are closing their doors. Walmart could stay open. That was okay. Our politicians could go get haircuts. It was okay. They didn't have to wear a mask or stay 6 feet away. I say things just to see if I get picked up sometime, and they just start nailing me or something, y'all. But fear, right? It was gripping our nation. It was the only thing being piped at us. The narrative and the story was being told over and over and over again. And then it got to where you were evil because you chose not to wear a mask and some chose masks. Then there was like create this division. And then like create the racial division, now create the sexual division. The world was throwing as much as we could at everybody just to create division and destruction. Ain't that what a bunch of little antichrists do? The opposite of who Christ is, that they come and they come and it comes and the messaging comes at you. Fear, an unpleasant emotion caused by the belief that someone or something is dangerous. A fear that would grip your heart, that would grip your life. There is a fear that is from God. Like if I step in the middle of the road and there's cars coming, I'm gonna die. You remember you always tell the kids don't play in the streets, right? A natural fear. Like, you stand on the edge of a cliff and you look down and you go, that's far down there. Right? That's what I do. I don't think I have a fear of heights, but on some spots it's like, I don't want to do that. Remember, I've told that story where my sister is 13 years old and comes to Arizona and we're jumping off these 50-foot cliffs into a lake. And it's like, this is like my second day on the job in Arizona. And pastor's like, hey, let's go here. We're gonna come. He was an old youth pastor too. He's like, take some kids and we'll go jump off cliffs. Okay. But you ever get up, you get to the spot and you're going, nah, it's really far. This is dumb. But then all your marbles go out the window when your 13-year-old sister jumps off. You're just like, well, she can do it. I can do it. She didn't die. I'm not gonna die. Fear. Caused by the belief that someone or something is dangerous. There is a lie that is perpetuated by the enemy that lies to us and deceives us. Fear is something that paralyzes us. It holds you back. You think the fear that's been used wasn't meant to hold you back, put you in check, keep the body of Christ in check, not let them meet together or gather together? Why do you think that is? You think they might know something? I think they do. They know what the body of Christ is about. They know what we stand for and what we believe. They know you and I will hold the line. What line am I talking about? The Word of God. Jesus Christ. So we go back to this idea of the rapture, and we know that that throughout Thessalonians, it's repeated and talked about multiple times. And we know, I'm not getting into when you believe that's going to be, if it's going to be post, pre, mid, whatever. You can get all into that if you want. We'll talk about it in a Bible study sometime. And there's all kinds of beliefs in that. Me personally, I believe it's going to be before, all right? I believe we're not going to go through some of the stuff that's going to take place because he's going to come back and get me. And I'll just wave to everybody else that was believing otherwise. But we go back to this idea and the fear that sometimes has been spoken and pushed down, that am I okay today? Did I sin today? But it's not the Holy Spirit convicting you. It's the do's and don'ts of the church. It's not that you shouldn't do something like that. You remember the do's and don'ts when you're dating, right? And the question is always from teenagers, like, how far is too far? Like, when am I going to sin? Like, when is this sinning? Can I, like, hold a hand? Is that okay? Like, can I give the person a kiss? Is that okay, or is that sinning? Am I lusting that, you know? You know what I'm saying? Sometimes I wonder if other people are thinking when I'm up here. Like, what do you think? This guy's crazy. But it's fear. Okay. So we think about COVID, and we think about these things that are used to manipulate and push us into believing something. And fear can do that. I'm not saying there's not a healthy dose of fear, right? Parents, amen? A little healthy dose of, man, I say that one, I will get ringed up online. Start talking about beating your kids. That guy's saying he beats kids. Let's talk about the rod. So sometimes, though, we have to unravel and unlearn something that we have learned over time in your past, the things that have caused and drive fear into our hearts. In verse 2 through 1, 2, it talks about the day of the Lord, this day. This day is a day of judgment that will come, but it's what I'm talking about is this period of time, judgments and justice. And you can actually look it up yourself in Amos chapter 5, and you can look up about the day of the Lord and what he's clearly talking about as the end day. But I want to talk about this idea as the day of the Lord, and the idea of it's about a heart matter. That Jesus is coming back because he's coming back for your heart. He's coming back for you. And so what have you done with your heart? Yes, there's going to be a final day. There's going to be a judgment, yes. But he's coming back for your heart. He's coming back for his people. He will bring judgment, but for us that know, he's coming back for you. And where is your heart at? He's reconciling hearts far from him to him. So he's bridging the gap over and over. He repeats things over and over, as Paul does, to remind us of the truth that we should listen to and adhere to. We all have fallen short. We have all fallen into the belief of believing a lie. And even the Thessalonians, they were getting caught up in this false Paul that was talking about these things and claiming these type things. So Paul was actually going, hey guys, this is the real truth. Here's what's gonna happen. So as Paul is bringing clarity once again in verse 2, that they have heard the truth, and he's reminding them. Sometimes we have to have these, what Paul does, hard conversations. You know what I'm talking about? Hard conversations. That we in the church and we in the body of Christ sometimes have to have hard conversations. People are so scared about having hard conversations. Paul clearly goes, hey, I'm going to tell you again. Like, don't believe that. I've told you once. I've told you again. So, telling you once, you know how many times you have to tell your kids something? You tell them once and they just do it all the time, right? But you have to tell them over and over and over again. Well, I find out that God has to tell us over and over and over again. Amen. Even the best of the best, even those in the Hall of Fame that we consider these are the top dogs, we're going to actually talk about that in our next series. We're going to talk about characters in the Bible. And there's a lot of characters in the Bible. Paul wasn't always Paul. David wasn't always a man after God's own heart. I'm sorry. He was sinning like the rest of them, too. You know what I'm saying? Peter, as wild as any of them, which I like because then he makes me feel good. If I need to throw a punch sometimes, I'm like, okay, Peter did it. That's why Royce is still around to hold me back, you know. But, we know that Jesus come back for our hearts. We know this. The mind is a servant of the heart. What you think leads to what you do. So what you think leads you to what you do. So if Paul doesn't get in here and remind them and write them once again, they are beginning to leave, they will begin to believe a lie And that lie, if it's believed, will cause them to begin to operate differently. So if we believe the fear-mongering going on, and we believe the narrative that's being pushed in our world, then we believe that all is lost. And there is no hope but the government themselves. And there is no hope but the Antichrist himself. This is the direction the world will go if you believe that lie. But our hope is in something different. Romans chapter 15, you can go there and it talks about it. Don't worry. Don't worry. I got you. I got you. There's hope. Love is coming alongside one another. And it's offering hope. Paul is coming alongside the Thessalonians and going, I got you. I'm here. I'm directing you. I'm going to remind you of the truth. We're here today to be reminded that Jesus is the way. We're being reminded that we're to worship him. We're to be reminded that we are to die to ourselves, not the I that live, that Christ live in me. Right? That is my hope, that Christ live in me. And that he kills everything that is not of him so that we can live in that holiness. That holiness cannot be manipulated or man-made. That holiness of the heart comes from Jesus Christ. It's the circumcision of the heart. We should be anticipating this day that's coming should not cause us to fear or run in scarcity or running in lack are running in fear and what to do and how are we going to make it. No, our hope is rested. We are resting not in our own self, but we are resting not in the church. We are resting in Jesus Christ, in God's arms. He is the creator and the ruler of the world. He has got you. He's got you. He's got you. He's got you. You have nothing to worry. Don't let the lie get a hold of your heart where you begin to live a false narrative, false truth. Stay centered. Stay anchored. Don't believe it. Don't believe it. God has you. He has made you. He loves you. He wants you to be with him in eternity. So don't walk in the lie, but walk in anticipation. Walk in the hope of our Savior, Jesus. But Paul's reminding us, don't be shaken. Don't be alarmed. Don't listen to the man of lawlessness. Don't listen to the little antichrist walking around. Think about Paul. He didn't fall into the lie. Paul was shipwrecked. He was persecuted. He knew everywhere he went, he was going to get persecuted. He just knew it was coming. Been in prison, been in jail, sings himself out, you know. He goes, nothing can kill me. Nothing can harm me. Nobody can take my soul. Every one of the disciples that went to their death serving Jesus, dying, many of them, a gruesome death, upside down on the cross, boiling oil, crucified, dying for what? For the hope that they know that Jesus is the answer. They knew Jesus was the way. There was no other way. They might not knew this, but we know it, and we quote it a lot. Absent from the body is to be. So, church, when it gets hard, when you go through suffering, know it's not the end. Know that there is hope. Know that Jesus has never left you. He has never left you. Don't believe the lie. He is with you. He is with you always. So what time do you have to evaluate? You have to evaluate your heart all the time. Our hearts are deceitfully wicked is what the Word of God says. I don't care how good you think you are. How close to Jesus you think you are. Our hearts are deceitfully wicked. And any one of us could fall at any moment. But we have an opportunity. We have this moment. We know the message of hope. So church, right now, we have hope. right now. We're standing on our feet right now. We know. Come on, stand on our feet this morning. Right now, we know Jesus is alive. Right now, you have the ability to connect with him. Right now, Jesus stands at the door. And so all you have to do is open it up. And you have everything I have. All I have is yours. All authority is given to you by the Father. That you are more than a conqueror. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Do you know what I'm saying? Greater is he that's in you. You that feel hopeless. You that feel lost, abandoned. You think there's no way. There's no way for you. You can't get out of this pit that you're in. Jesus says, greater is he that's in you. He has made you more than a conqueror. Your soul is in the hands of our Creator, Father God. And that is all that matters. This world will pass away. We will all face judgment. We will all face death at some point. But our lives are in his hands. In his hands. If you've given your heart to Jesus, it's in his hands. That thing you're worrying about, that thing you're stressing about, you know what that is. It's in his hands. Quit trying to take the wheel. Quit trying to control it. You control freaks, let it go. You that think there is no hope, look to Jesus. Lift your hands up in praise to Jesus. Surrender your life. Surrender every part of you. Scripture says, search me, O God, and know if there be any wicked way within me. Are you still searching? You should be. It's one of my favorite verses. God, search me and know if there be any wicked way within me. May I die to myself that you may live. May I die to that addiction that you know I need to surrender to you. That pattern of life that I always blame on Granddad because he did it. May I die to that because that's not of you, Jesus. May I die because I still have an issue with my mouth. May I die to that thing because I just don't want to. You don't want to do that. Jesus is calling you to do something. You're going, I don't want to. And you're like a spoiled brat kid going, I don't want to. We all been there. We know. Everybody laughs because we all know we do it. Can I tell you a secret? It's easier to just give it over to him. It's easier to surrender to him. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Be people of obedience. Let's close your eyes for a moment. Jesus, we thank you for this day that we set apart to lift you up. And we take our mornings on Sundays to corporately come together and worship you. We take these moments as we, as the family and body of Christ, come alongside of one another. Maybe like Paul, we come alongside one another, remember, to help remind people, to remind one another, to love one another, to speak truth and kindness, because we know it's his loving kindness that leads us to repentance. It's his loving kindness that leads me to surrender and give things over to my Savior. This morning, in this room, Lord God, sure, there's heartache and there's pain. There's trials of every kind. There's temptation. There's hardships. And God, even sufferings taking place in many of our lives here or online. But I know that we are not to be shaken, not to be troubled, but help us to be attentive to your voice. Help our ears to be in tune with your frequency, that we could hear clearly, we could see clearly, and we could answer you, Jesus, with obedience. Pray that you'll bless each one of us, Lord, today. They're coming and are going. Bless, watch over, guard and protect. Use moment after moment in our lives, Lord, to teach us, to guide us, to direct us, and to love us. We're your kids, and we know we're not always obedient kids. But today, we say our lives are yours. Have your way in each one of us. We surrender. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Church, be blessed. Walk in God's word. Be obedient, kids. Listen clearly to his voice and surrender your life. I'm telling you, you'll not fear what comes. God bless you. We'll see everybody Wednesday night or next Sunday morning. Invite a friend. Compel someone to come with you. Don't just invite them, compel them to be here. God bless you.